Come with us now, if you dare, down a rickety staircase into a dank, dark basement. What awaits? The Saturday Night Freak Show.
Thank you for listening to the Saturday Night Freak Show podcast.
Thank you.
Thank you. Colin.
No, really. Thank you.
Thank Colin.
You.
We're pointing at you guys in case you can tell by our voice. We're pointing at you.
Yep. We kind of do this thing Braylor. Every Saturday night. We do it. We have been doing it for almost 300 episodes.
Wow.
I know. We've lost count.
Colin.
We're closing in. Who are
you? You know,
these?
You have to remind us when it's coming.
Yeah,
I know. I got to look because we're going to miss it.
You're the only one that knows the actual number.
I think we're within like 5 weeks of it now.
I was like, isn't it in like September?
It's like end of September, yeah. I think. Yeah.
Okay.
We're getting close.
We did this math. I thought it was still in October.
But we don't we don't remember these things, Sean.
It was in October because we were thinking about doing Halloween and then we're like, oh, fuck. No, it's going to be before that.
But I thought I went back and looked at it. And I thought
we'll do the math off, Mike, and figure it out.
Now let's do it right now.
So we'll open our calendar app.
What number is this, Colin? No idea.
280. I don't know. We're in the 280s. 290s? Somewhere.
I'm
checking.
All right. Well, while remain.
28. This is 290.
We're on 290. Holy cow. Within 10.
All right.
Of the big three.
Countdown, guys. This is the countdown.
But thank you for joining us on this milestone, 290th episode of the Saturday Night Freak Show. So listen, tell you what, we want you to write into us.
Look at us.
Tell us what you think about what we're doing here by getting us on Facebook.
Facebook.com/SaturdayNightFreakShow.
On Twitter.
So distracted.
At Sat Freak Show.
On email.
SaturdayNightFreakShow@yahoo.com.
Or follow us on Instagram for the time of your life. Who are the people who are talking to you?
Holly.
Sean.
Michaela.
And I'm Colin.
During that moment, I just remembered Twitter existed. Twitter's a thing. At Sat Freak Show.
You have one.
Yeah, I do.
And you follow the Saturday Night Freak Show for the time of your life. We're going to talk about a movie tonight, and then we're going to read some of your mail, and then we're going to go around the room and tell you what we thought about the movie. The movie tonight was chosen by...
Kayla. What do we watch tonight?
We watched 2015's Blumhouse feature, The Boy Next Door. I was going to say Masterpiece, but I was like...
Masterpiece.
This isn't the first Blumhouse movie we've done on the show.
No, this is. I mean, we've done a bunch.
Have we?
There's a lot of things that are considered Blumhouse movies. You'd be like, "What? That's a Blumhouse movie?" You know, like
that's very true.
I know we did Lords of Salem. That was a Blumhouse movie.
I have no idea.
You done Paranormal Activity that was distributed by Blumhouse, but not made by them. You know, that's the thing. Like sometimes they pick up things for distribution. Sometimes they make them. Sometimes they make them, and then someone else distributes them. It's
and they chose to make this movie.
Yep. They did.
We talk about them a lot anyway. Yeah. So
that's very true.
We name drop Blumhouse, so it's appropriate that you know we have a Blumhouse movie.
It's appropriate that
if it's 2018, you don't know who Blumhouse is. You're living under a rock at this point.
That's right. So this movie's directed by.
The one and only, master Rob Cohen.
The legend.
Hollywood trash peddler.
You know,
what
that guy.
Happened to Rob Cohen? Rob Cohen is
never been good. That's my argument. He's
the guy
always been terrible.
He was a kid, like working in the scripts or something. He was, he identified the sting, which became like a
best picture.
He
found the sting in a trash pile, yeah.
Yeah. In the mailroom or something.
He started his career dumpster diving. The movie The Sting
with Paul Newman and Robert Redford.
That script was like thrown away as in like, don't make this movie.
Really?
He discovered it and told someone to make it and it was made.
That's a good movie.
It's a great movie.
He didn't make it. He just told someone to make it.
I know he didn't make it, but yeah.
Cohen was, because if I remember correctly, he was like responsible for a bunch of TV, like MASH. Mm-hmm. He's the guy who was the executive in charge of production or whatever at 20th Century Fox TV.
He's been adjacent to a lot of good things, but not necessarily involved with a lot of good
things. Well,
what did
he do as a director? Because I suppose that's where,
A Small Circle of Friends.
The Skulls.
The Skulls.
Right. He did The Skulls.
Yeah.
Yep.
Bravo.
Stealth, one of the worst movies I think I've ever seen.
Dragonheart.
Dragonheart.
Yep.
A movie I thought would be on the Freak Show before The Boy Next Door, to be honest with you, but okay.
Yeah.
That's fair.
The original Fast and the Furious.
Yeah.
Yep.
And then he teamed up with Vin Diesel again
Triple X.
That's right.
Mm. Yeah.
That's
right, because
Stealth
Hollywood
came after
trash
that.
Peddler, yep.
Well, that was probably...
I was going to say, I have a connection to Rob Cohen.
And what is that?
I was in an Oscar pool with him 1 year. that's my connection to Rob Cohen.
Well, his career like seemed to peak somewhere around. Was it like, I mean, because it was like Dragonheart and the Dragon, the Bruce Lee story and the Skulls. They were all hits, I think, right?
Yeah.
And
yeah,
then,
the Skulls was big back in the day. Like, yeah, that was a big movie.
Yeah, because
that had everybody in it. Paul Walker and
Joshua Jackson and yeah, like,
other people.
Like the big 90s people. Yeah.
Yeah. That's a big one.
That's a big one.
But I mean, it
I'll
seems
tell you
like
where he went downhill.
Oh, well, I
Tomb of the Dragon Emperor.
That's right.
I couldn't. Yep. That's a movie I couldn't finish.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I was just like, ugh. Yeah. No.
Well, he was the guy you bring in when Steven Summers says
right.
No.
Yeah.
Who you go, who else do we got? Rob Cohen. He'll do it. Okay. So Rob comes in, does Tomb of the Dragon Emperor.
Tony Scott says no, too. Which Tony Scott doesn't say no to a lot of things.
How dare you compare Tony Scott to Rob Cohen?
Or to Steven Summers. Good
or
guy.
To Steven Summers.
Yeah, yeah. Tony Scott's a goddamn fucking genius.
There was one. Sorry, guys. I got a story. There was at one point in time, there was a rumor going around that Tony Scott was going to do a Warriors remake set in L.A.
Oh,
okay. Lots of things wrong with these words I'm saying.
Yeah.
Right? You know, and this is when I was an edgier, more careless person.
Sure.
And I was in college and I said, that's fucking stupid. I hope he jumps off a bridge and kills himself.
Oh,
Jesus.
Michaela, too soon. Too soon.
This is before he killed himself that I said that. And then that happened.
You killed
you
Tony
see the
Scott.
Correlation, yeah. The causation that's
Tony
going
Scott.
On here.
You killed him.
Yeah. Killed Tony Scott.
I killed Tony Scott.
Please
but,
don't ever
but hey, I spared
me.
Us from that Warriors remake, so you're welcome.
Well, then, what would you leave us with? What was his last movie, Unstoppable? Was
it I think so.
He made two train movies with Denzel in them. He can go fuck himself.
Was,
Well, he can't now.
Yeah,
he did The Taking of Pelham 1-2-3 and Unstoppable. Two
I would
train
watch,
movies
I would
with
watch
Denzel
the shit
in them.
Of Unstoppable. I have not seen it, but I would watch the shit out of that movie.
It wasn't a bad
he
movie.
He also made Deja Vu.
I know. He didn't really make
for.
Bad movies.
No,
Tony
didn't.
Scott was
he,
like,
he
that's
did,
what you're like.
He did Man on Fire, which
yeah.
is a really good movie.
He did True Romance. True Romance.
I really like that movie.
True Romance. Yeah, that's very true.
My personal, one of my favorites.
I wouldn't exactly call him an auteur. I would say he made
he
passable
a,
movies.
That,
that
guy
doesn't make
he's
him
got
great.
A,
but I think,
feel a look, and that is Tony Scott.
Tony Scott invented, I think, the look of
debatable.
MTV.
Ooh. The look of MTV?
Yeah.
How?
Well, he did. I mean, if you look at like if you go back and look at like The Hunger or Top Gun or like any, or Days of Thunder, all that stuff, it's like all MTV music videos, at least in that period of time, looked exactly like his movies.
Dangerous.
I wonder if he did.
But what
music?
Came first?
The Hunger. I don't know.
But like, no, what came first? Like MTV movies or Tony Scott directing movies? That's the thing.
Tony
like,
Scott directing movies.
And I'm sure he did a shit ton of music videos.
I bet.
I would guarantee
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
He may. Have,
I think
he
that's
may
a
have,
safe bet.
He may have. He may have
more than David
MTV.
Fincher.
David Fincher did a lot of commercials.
He did a lot of
I
music
think,
videos.
Well, actually,
too.
I think maybe maybe we're backwards on that because maybe Fincher did a lot of music videos and Tony Scott did a lot of commercials. Like perfume ads and
sure.
whatever the fuck.
I'm sure they had their.
I think, yeah, the Scott brothers.
You know, you all
brothers.
Were so diehard for Tony Scott.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So you
Tony
would have
Scott's
watched
a hero.
Reboot directed by Tony Scott?
I would have.
Yeah, probably.
Set in LA.
Yeah, I would have watched it.
Because it was
y'all
a Tony
have no
Scott
respect
film.
For the original movie then.
I wouldn't watch Rob Cohen's Alex Cross.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So this is where it happened, yeah. right? It was Tomb of the Dragon Emperor, then Alex Cross, and then what was the. Probably the boy next door. And then Hurricane Heist.
Hurricane Heist.
Yeah, sure.
That's where he's at right
now. He deserves it. Look at the movies he's made in the past 10 years. He deserves to be there. I don't feel bad for him.
I don't feel bad for him either.
No, he made a shit ton of money directing this movie, so I definitely don't feel bad for
Rob
him.
Rob Cohen is someone I would consider a hack filmmaker.
Yeah, same. Yeah.
Who got lucky. I mean, don't get me wrong.
No,
Fast and Furious is a decent
rip-off. He fell ass backwards
break.
Into all of this.
Yeah.
Like, and it makes me frustrated because it's like, who is he preventing from working that could be making better movies? Like, why? Like, who are they? Like, they're hiring him instead of hiring someone else that could be making better stuff. Is the way I view it. Mm-hmm. Is he's taking jobs away from potentially better people?
I mean, when you got movies like Hurricane Heist, though, I mean,
yeah.
Do you want to?
Has anybody seen Hurricane Heist?
Yeah,
no.
Yeah.
I would watch it though. Yep. Not gonna lie.
You say you'd never get it.
Not on purpose.
The hurricane has
like,
a face.
Hey, we're watching
it's got a face.
This.
He's like. Because that fucking Steven Summers was able to do the fucking cloud of the face and the
it's
mummy before
yeah.
I did,
mm-hmm.
before my mummy,
yeah.
I'm gonna fucking so put
it. Yeah. The rainy storm face.
Yeah, yeah. It doesn't make sense. There's so that's many ridiculous. Problems with that movie, but
it is ridiculous.
It should have been a sci-fi movie that make somehow.
Me want to watch this movie.
No, you don't. You won't like it.
No, you'll watch it and be like, what, how is this not on the Sci-Fi Channel?
Mm-hmm. I mean, yeah, exactly. Yeah. That was my thought watching it.
Yeah, exactly.
Why is this not a sci-fi movie?
Again, I will never do it on purpose. But
will he ever make a theatrical film again, or is his career basically over?
If he's in 2018, back, yes. If he made the Hurricane Heist 2018 that came out in theaters, yeah, he'll make another movie.
Well, how successful was his venture into Blumhouse territory?
Insanely successful.
How much did this movie cost?
$4.2 million.
How much did it make? Wait, don't tell me.
Going to guess?
Damn it.
$55 million.
$55 million.
Wow. This is a ridiculously profitable
People
movie.
Love J-Lo.
Well, and
so. Do they?
Yes,
do they?
Yes.
Was
they
Angel
do.
Eyes like a big hit?
This they movie opened J-Lo. At number two its opening weekend, just behind American Sniper. So
opening
was,
weekend, American yeah. Sniper.
Well, no, American Sniper had been out for 2 weeks, I think. This was a fuck you January movie, so,
mm-hmm. So nobody which makes had anything sense. To do. They're so. Just like, hey, J-Lo's in a, and you know,
right,
the but, guys are like, yeah, I'll go with you to see that because they're like Jennifer Lopez yeah. is scantily clad in that yeah. movie. I will see it.
But for this movie to open at number two is kind of a big deal. Mm-hmm. Like,
I'll give you that.
That's big.
Yeah,
it made back its budget in its Friday debut alone.
Yeah, but I mean, I suppose that's where we're at now. It's like a movie's considered a hit at $50 million, where it used to be like, you know, $50 million, you're not even clearing anything.
It depends
but because,
on the movie and its well, budget.
Yeah, you but
know, this
I know.
It's a low budget
yeah.
movie, so yeah, $50 million.
That's the genius of Jason Blum, right?
Exactly.
It's like, well, $50 million might be shit for everybody else, but if I make it for $5 million, oh, sorry, you said $5 million?
4.2. Mm-hmm.
Then it'll score huge. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter what it does.
It so did it's 15 million its opening weekend. That's huge for yeah. a movie of this like small of budget. Mm-hmm. And that's like you said, yeah, that's the genius of Jason Blum is that he kind of treats it like a Silicon Valley like venture capitalist. Like he makes a bunch of small gambles on movies and he'll release 10 movies in a year. And yeah, he's going to expect yeah. four of them to fail, but those six that succeed are going to be so big that it'll finance the whole next year of movies.
You feel like yeah. his business model is changing a little bit in recent years because like when we were watching
Post
this
Get Out it has to
well yeah. I mean that's what I'm saying while I was watching this one I was struck by the fact that you know it takes place in a Blumhouse style house which it probably
There's
was left over from
yeah. Max yeah.
but it's probably been used in Insidious or Ouija or you know one of those one of the movies that they've done. I don't know the last Blumhouse movie I've seen that took place in a house like this. Mm-hmm. Like, we've moved on, right?
That was yeah. my question. Was her farmhouse the Insidious house?
It might have been.
I think probably. It was. Right?
Yeah. They do do that a lot.
I
they
think
reuse
it was.
A lot of the sure. same sets.
Like, I've seen this farmhouse mm-hmm. before.
Yeah, for as much money as they don't want to spend, mm-hmm. they would definitely reuse anything they could.
Yeah, you just redress it.
Yeah.
We should actually go back, and at some point, it's going to be like, yeah, just like, that's the Blumhouse house. Mm-hmm. That so is that. So, look, the yeah. windows are in the same place. There's the door. Yep.
We can do that with Halloween when it comes out.
Well, that wasn't shot in California.
Oh, yeah, that was in
North Carolina. Because there's a replica house in North Carolina that's actually more realistic to the Myers house than the one in the real one, which is really sad to think yeah. about. But, yeah. So the way there's a really good episode of Planet Money where they interview Jason Blum about like his process and how he makes movies and stuff. And I listened to it and they were kind of talking about how when he makes movies, there are three rules that like he is like hard and fast with. And the first one is extras never speak. And the reason for that is
don't have to pay him.
Well, yeah. it's an extra $500 if they speak.
Right.
Like, so it's $100 a day, normal day rate. If they don't speak,
that's why there
as
were no extras in any scene in this movie. That's why everybody was just going to let that kid die
yep.
when he had an allergic reaction to something.
Yeah.
The air, oh, the dust coming
activity.
Off the boxing thing.
Yeah,
like, oh my
activity,
God, I stress my
yeah.
heart
are
too
we,
much.
Yeah, we need to get into this fucking yeah. movie.
And then his second rule is limit the number of sets. Jason Blum prefers to film every movie inside a house if possible. Obviously, sure. that limits what can happen and stuff like that. But he said his ideal movie would take place all inside one house. And I was like,
I think he's made that movie.
I was like, have you ever seen The Babadook, man? Like, that's your dream movie right there. How did you not pick that up for distribution? Like, The Babadook takes place inside one fucking house the whole time.
Yeah. Or The Purge.
Yeah.
like
it
most
depends
of
on which purge you're talking about.
The first one.
The second one is like three different houses.
Yeah. The first movie of the purge.
Zing.
Don't give me too much credit. That's like the second time I've made that joke on this podcast. When you're having sex with Jennifer Lopez, you don't really need to go to many locations.
Yeah.
You need a house.
No, you don't.
That's true.
That's it.
Uh-huh. And his third rule is if the movie profits, you profit. He treats it as that all the actors and the people working on it get an equity stake in the movie so that if the movie does well financially, they will earn more. And that is kind of a motivator. Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. It's a great motivator, and it's a great motivation for them to do PR and to promote the movie and things like that.
Yeah, the better
and
I do, the better this movie will do. And
exactly.
Make some bank.
And Rob Cohen worked 23 days on this movie. This movie was shot in 23 days, and he made $2 million on that. So that's pretty great, you know. Yeah. Like
I'm gonna go make Boy Next Door for that deal.
Right, exactly.
Right now,
exactly.
So.
Absolutely.
So. Well, this had to be like a step down for J Lo then, because I mean,
she brought her own
Stars fading when it comes to movies, though. Like, when was the last movie you saw her in that like the backup plan? And that was like what, maybe
like
a couple
starring
years before
movie,
this?
Or like, are you saying a good movie or
just like her
movie?
Being
just
a leading movie. Lady? In.
She's got one coming out later this year.
Made in Manhattan.
What is it called?
Oh, I fucking don't remember.
Yep, yeah, exactly. No, but like she's not what she was maybe like 10, 15 years
not
ago.
Not when she made The Cell, am I right? Another movie I thought would have made it onto the Saturday Night Freak Show before this one.
I'm sure there were people that were born in the year 2000 that don't
hold
really
on.
Understand
I don't
why
think
she's famous.
I've seen that movie. Wait. Let me put
well,
it that
she's,
way.
She, because she... She became she started off as an actress and became a singer and kind of did.
She was a dancer.
She started out as a fly girl.
She was a fly girl.
Then
true.
Became an actress.
Honey
then became
color
a singer.
With the Wayans brothers, right? Mm-hmm. And then, so I think maybe that's why she's like, maybe, you know, people know her more as a singer now than an actress. Because now it's like she's
honestly,
an actress.
Honestly, I think it's kind of 50-50.
Yeah, she's
really
got it split down
the middle,
I think
it's kind of
50-50.
I think she's really good. Okay, even in this, I thought like she was
best.
Better than the material was. I mean, it was like, yeah, you're good at what you do. You know?
Yeah,
she
I don't think
her
she's
all,
bad.
All her own wardrobe too. She like she provided all her own clothes for this.
You
movie.
Can tell because like, it's classy.
Yeah, right.
Because like, she knows
and
how to
she
dress
knows,
herself.
Right, she knows what she looks good in.
Yeah, she knows how to dress herself.
Those pajamas were. Yeah,
that
those
was
were nice.
Wonderful.
Those were nice.
Even she was
all little
teacher
getup. Yeah,
yeah.
Like her sweaters and shit. I was like, man, she dresses.
Even her sweaters, I was like, man, I want that. Sweater, yeah. Like you know, like yeah,
it was a nice jacket.
Well.
I like it.
And we got a little bit of the famous insured
the rump?
Posterior, a little bit.
Yeah.
In there, yeah,
yeah.
I've got to show that if you're
insure
if it's insured. I mean, yeah, it's got
well
to make shape your money
insurance
maker.
Policy is still active.
Was
that was
a
long time
stunt?
Ago?
Was that just for a year?
No, but that was like 20 years ago probably that happened. I don't
know. But if you keep paying for it, it doesn't
like
expire.
I don't think it's as bankable now as it was 20 years ago.
So what
is
do
what
you,
I'm saying.
What are you insured against?
I think if like
flood damage
it's sitting
like
on a hot I don't know.
I think
on a hot tin roof.
I think it's like this is where my value comes from. So if something happens to this, like I still
that's
maintain
like
my
ridiculous.
Value.
Ridiculous.
Like what? Is,
I don't know. I don't really know
what,
how. That,
I want to know the details
know.
In this contract.
Yeah. If you're an insurance policy person,
me
please
and
tell
just
us.
Just cuts my ass.
Yeah.
Is that like, I don't know.
Maybe it's like a plastic surgery type thing. Maybe it's like if I go for this treatment and it's fucking botched, then I'm covered. Maybe that's what
right.
it is. I don't know. I don't know how that shit works. Mm. I don't have any of my body parts insured other than basic health insurance, so I don't
Sean
know how that works.
So sincere just now. He wants to know. He wants to know.
I'd be interested, dear listener, if you know.
Oh, yeah. Send us
please.
The details. Give us the deets.
Links, something.
Yeah. To the policy. Yeah. Or just photos, you know, that were used for the policy. Because I imagine
well,
you got to get someone to like your,
it, right?
Yeah, like a car. You got to. This is what it looks like now.
Which you probably had to get X-rays to prove it's not implants, too, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Like I imagine she had to go through all that,
probably,
like, and have some doctor assess. Like, yep,
this is
legit.
The greatest thing ever. People insuring their ass.
Yeah,
yeah,
like
it's true though. Kim Kardashian had the whole thing where she went on her reality show and got like X-rays live on TV to prove she didn't have butt implants. Like, I believe that is
right.
like J-Lo.
Thank
had to
you,
go through
J-Lo,
all the same shit.
For setting that up for
yeah.
us.
Yeah, mm-hmm. exactly.
All right, so we're 18 minutes into this podcast. We haven't even talked about what the hell this movie is about because it's Fatal Attraction of 2015. I think somebody actually said it was the Fatal Attraction of 2015.
Oh, I'm sure.
It's an erotic thriller. Is that fair or unfair?
I would say so.
Yeah, that's fair.
I'll give you that.
Okay, which has basically been a kind of what would you call it, an endangered species at the movies.
Yeah, yeah. And that's why, like, there needs to be more of this genre.
And that's why it made so much money, because they're just like, they made a film for adults.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's R-rated, guys. Aren't you excited about that? It's not like an erotic thriller that's PG-13. Right. It's like very censored and like held back. Like, I was so excited when I found out this movie was R-rated. I was like, yay.
I remember, there was Fatal Attraction. I'm trying to think, like, what the movie was before that, where someone falls, or, you know, has a one-time affair. No, before Fatal Attraction. Where someone has an affair with somebody, and then that person turns out to be a psycho and comes after, you know, to ruin your entire family.
There was...
probably an episode of a TV show.
No, isn't there... Doesn't Beyonce or Idris Elba do this movie every year?
Before Fatal Attraction.
Before Fatal Attraction.
Okay. Yeah, it's obsessed,
and it's amazing.
Yeah.
It's great.
The next big thing after Fatal Attraction was probably like Basic Instinct. And then there was the Shivers and the Body of Evidence the Wild Things and all that.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
Then there was then in the 2000s, I think late 90s, 2000s, mm-hmm. they made everybody like 19 years old, and it was Swim Fan. And it was
Swim Fan.
Right?
Oh, yeah. I can get down with some Swim Fan.
There's several other, they switched the sexes and made him younger, but you know, I'm sure in there, there's probably movies I'm forgetting about. And then finally, we brought it back with The Boy Next Door. I'm sure it's living on in the lifetime.
Obsessed. Unforgettable? Catherine Heigl came out last year.
Yeah. Rosario Dawson.
That one.
I'm sure Taraji Henson is in a bunch of them.
Mm-hmm. Taraji, that's all she does. What was that?
Right.
No Good Deed with Tyler Perry.
Yep.
Yeah. No, wait.
Like that's her bread and butter.
Idris Elba?
I don't think so. I feel like it was like a lookalike.
No, I think that...
No, that was probably Morris Chestnut.
He
shows up in
That's her husband, and Idris Elba is the guy who I think I saw that.
That sounds right, but I don't like.
They make this movie every year.
Yeah,
okay. The same people.
So
they do. And once a year, there's this movie that comes out.
Okay, listeners, if you all haven't seen, this is a long ass title, so bear with me. Tyler Perry's Temptation: Confessions of a Marriage Counselor.
There it is.
Fucking watch that movie, because if you like this kind of like erotic thriller, like stage drama kind of thing, that movie is wild.
Like if you cheat, you get AIDS.
Spoiler alert. Jesus Christ, John.
Yes.
I'm sorry.
Yes.
If that doesn't make you go see the movie more than not knowing anything about it.
The moral of the story is you cheat on your husband, you get AIDS. Yes, that is what happens.
Well,
he's the pharmacist. You have to get your AIDS meds from him for the rest of your life.
Wow.
That's
poetic justice right there.
Go to a
in
different
the world
pharmacy
of Tyler Perry.
Deal with that.
She doesn't.
Well, that's her own fault. She's punishing herself. She's like, I deserve this.
Well,
that and the AIDS.
Let
me ask you this. I mean, in this type of movie, when you sit down to watch or you buy your ticket to go see it, like what do you need the movie to do that you haven't seen done six other times a year? I mean, what?
I don't need it to. I just need it to be salacious and be fun and have like a good forward momentum.
But that's what it needs to separate it from the pack.
It doesn't need to be separate. It can be the same thing I've seen a million fucking times.
This is just your jam, is what you're telling me.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm the one who goes to see this movie.
I mean,
I don't care who's in it, I'm there.
Yeah, we're rattling off all these movies that have come out to actual like theaters. Mm-hmm. I've been watching this shit on Lifetime forever.
Same, yeah.
This is my bread and butter.
And that's the thing. Like, we watch it so much on Lifetime.
Yes.
When it does get a big budget, it makes it to a full-blown theater. I'm like, I am all in.
Yes.
Because I've been watching the cheap cable version of the shit for forever.
This never happens.
Yeah, exactly.
So it's like, okay, now you're telling me that it's got a budget, it's Blumhouse and rated R.
It's gonna and the director of the Fast and the
what
Furious, it's
doing?
Gonna have car chases and muscle cars and shit's gonna explode.
No, that's not here for any of that.
Things exploded, but it was more of a personal sexual nature.
There was gross explosion.
Thank you.
Yep.
So teacher. J-Lo.
Yeah.
She's
the classics literature.
Right.
And she says a million times in this movie. J.K. Rowling, classics major.
Who's the script?
The script is not a classic. I will say that.
Let's talk. All of us have been to high school. There are not specific English classes just for the classics.
No, there's you take English and AP.
You don't have.
It's curriculum. It's fucking Common Core, Sean. Yeah. It's fucking freshman
English, sophomore English, junior.
Maybe AP if you're lucky. You know.
Yeah.
Yeah. You're reading The Great Gatsby. That's all.
At best, I think when I was a junior, it was British literature. Or something like that.
Yeah.
It's not just the classics. Yeah, no.
The classics.
But this is kind of the screenplays, thank you. It's one of the ways that this screenplay can give the characters something to talk about other than the plot of this movie. I swear to God, every time that the family got together, because J-Lo is married to
John Corbett.
From Northern Exposure. No, is it Northern Exposure?
And My Big Fat Greek Wedding.
Fucking Aiden from Sex and the City.
He's been in so many things.
He's a very tall man.
Yeah, very tall.
And she has a 16 year old kid.
I don't know. Imagine this kid played by RJ Meat from Breaking Bad. Yeah. Okay, imagine Walt Jr. playing this fucking kid. It'd be so much better, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Like, if you just switched out that, like, because that kid's trying to do that, right? Like, he's trying to be Walt Jr.
I would feel
from
less
Breaking
sorry
Bad.
For RJ Mitty than I do for this kid in this movie. I hate this child.
Well, you're supposed to feel sorry for him, aren't you?
He accomplished it in spades. I don't like
all right, well, let's
feels
set up.
Like he's a poor man's version of that, right? Like, he feels like, he's even got the kind of, like, hair the same way and the weird, like, I don't know, his presence. It seems like that kid watched a lot of Breaking Bad and was like, I can do that.
Well, for the folks at home that haven't actually seen the movie, I suppose we should, before we talk about these enlightening things, which I'm sure are going to be, we have to at least tell them what's going on here. What's the family dynamic? What is the dynamic here in between all these characters?
So you got Jennifer Lopez. Claire Peterson is estranged from her husband, John Corbett, because he cheated on her with his secretary that somehow lives...
Rice-a-roni secretary.
Yeah, that lives in San Francisco.
That's the Rice-a-roni joke.
That's this script.
Because in, like, literally the first, like, what, five lines of this movie, Kristen... Chenoweth says something about, like, oh, that's the other San Francisco treat or something, right?
Speaking of the beginning of this movie, it gives you,
it goes
like,
so
this...
so fast!
So was that, like, filmed and they condensed it because the movie was running long? It's like a half a second of a scene and then a half a second of a scene with voiceover explaining that he cheated on her.
She's jogging and has a panic attack.
Yeah.
And it's
the most, like, jarring, weird.
It's
like,
it goes too fast. It's very weird.
It's not a good setup for your movie.
No.
It's kind of embarrassing.
It's so odd and off-putting that we're not even actually listening to what they're saying.
Because we were reeling in peals of laughter from the, like, Claire, I'm so sorry kick me out of the house.
Yes.
Get out, you son of a bitch, or whatever.
Yeah. Crying and saying, because nobody speaks. It is all, like, ADR. It's all voiceover. And then people turning and walking away angrily.
I've seen this movie more than once, so I knew this, but you guys kind of missed like a key piece of that voiceover of, like, the conversation with Kristen Chenoweth was that, like, in the emails that she was, like, quoting, like, he had said that, like, the Rice-a-roni secretary smelled like cookies. Yeah. All the time.
Yeah, so I missed that. So I missed that joke. Yeah. Sniffs the cookies later
on,
like,
in the movie, she sniffs the cookies, doing? And we're like, you guys were all like, why the fuck is she sniffing?
Yeah.
Because there was literally a scene dedicated to just her sniffing a chocolate chip cookie and nothing else happens. That is the only thing that happens in that scene.
Mm-hmm.
And you guys were like, what the fuck was that?
Full of hate and the smell of the chocolate chip and the macadamia.
What Rice-a-roni smells like.
Also, Kristen Chenoweth is in this movie.
Don't
let that turn you off to everything else.
But you're a Sorkin fan and you don't like Chenoweth?
Has Chenoweth been in Sorkin?
Have you watched The West Wing? I don't even watch The West Wing and I know she's in like half of it. She also dated Aaron Sorkin for a very long time.
I don't know. I skip whatever she's in.
Okay.
I thought you had like all The West Wing on DVD.
Mm-hmm.
No.
You didn't?
I learned something new about your co-hosts all the time.
Don't you question my Sorkin love.
I am, because you didn't know about her.
Yeah, I thought every Sorkin fan...
I haven't watched it recently.
Yeah. I thought every Sorkin fan was obsessed with The West Wing.
Yeah,
I love The West Wing. I have not watched
Yeah, she's got like a major role in that series.
Later on.
Several seasons.
She was great on Frasier. That's what I'm going to go
with. Frasier?
Oh, yeah. So
maybe earlier on. I can't stand her now. Ugh.
All right, so the setup of this is, like, the husband's cheated, so he's not living at home, and...
But they're kind of, it seems like they're kind of keep, like, off and on, like, going back and forth.
Right.
Are they or aren't they kind of thing?
Because he stopped cheating.
He stopped, and then he started again, and then he stopped.
Kristen Chenoweth says, it's been 9 months, Claire, and you haven't signed the papers. So, like, she's clearly been, like, they've been, like, separated for 9 months or whatever. And, like,
it's on the skids. Yeah. It's on the rocks. It's heading out. It's almost done. Then a boy moves in next door. A 20-year-old.
Nearly 20-year-old.
To take care of his great uncle.
His great uncle, which I'm so glad that they cleared that up.
Yeah, he was like old as shit. The
cantankerous old bastard.
So this is taking care of my uncle, and we're like, what?
That man is like, he fought in World War II. I'm swearing to God.
There's no resolution to that. We never like get the full, like, how did his transport, as they say, go?
Yeah. Like, his blood marrow transport? Like 3/4 of the way through the movie, I was like, how's the uncle? Like, is he okay?
He's up walking around scaring the shit out of people later on.
Yeah, when he's wheelchair bound in the first act. Yeah, so apparently the bone marrow transport went okay.
See, you're saying that he was out of the, because the whole time, like, shit's going on in the house with the uncle apparently lives in. And Michaela's telling us that, like, well, the uncle's not there because he's gone to get his transplant.
That's what he said.
And I'm like,
that's what she said. She said, oh, you don't have anyone to have dinner with. Come over and have dinner with us because he's home alone.
He's at the hospital. Oh,
okay. All right. Yeah. Because I'm maintaining that somewhere that fucking guy's still upstairs and they just forgot about him for a little
bit. I mean, that's entirely possible because
you're right.
It's entirely possible.
But so the guy moves in next door and he immediately makes an impression on J-Lo because he also loves the classics and he brings her.
Oh, Jesus.
A gift.
Jesus, mother of God.
I can't. This part makes me fucking tear my hair out. What's I can't deal with this.
The gift is a first edition of the Iliad.
Ooh, how rare.
Now,
listener, just take a minute and think about it. Just let it.
The Iliad.
A 3,000-year-old
first edition.
First edition.
A story that was told orally for 3,000 years, you know.
Uh-huh. And it's a story that's in the
This is the English domain. English you can, first
anybody
edition.
Anybody can publish this
I don't know.
Story.
And and not only that, as if you're like, wow, okay, that would, like you do the mental gymnastics to be like, okay, he found a first edition, right? Must be really expensive, right? Then he follows it up with found it for a buck at a garage sale.
Yeah.
So it's trash, basically. Valuable, but it's trash.
But it's one of these moments that, like, makes you, because you do kind of stop. I mean, I think we all did, like, audibly go like, wait, what?
Yeah.
And you stop. It stops the movie because you're like, wait a second, hold on. How does this? You're sitting there telling me that in this major Hollywood production, no one. Anywhere associated with this, stop to say, like,
this had to pass by.
I don't know about this line.
Exactly. How many people were involved in this fucking movie, and not one of them knows how old that is?
I guess they never passed senior English.
No one has read the fucking thing. They just, it's a device.
I have.
I feel like,
I know, but in
Hollywood.
But here's the goddamn thing of it. No one should had to have read it. They should just know.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone knows how old that book is.
Especially
that story is.
If you're passing it off as this is your way as a screenwriter of basically trying to make your characters upscale, right? It's like they're into classic literature.
They're educated.
Like, I haven't actually read it myself, but I can go to Bartlett's quotations and I can pull, like, you know, some specific moments from it and put it into my script, and that makes me sound like I'm literate.
But there's so many other classic novels that would be so much easier to, like, that would just make so much more sense. Like, To Kill a Mockingbird, do that. Like, that's a classic novel.
Annie Fitzgerald, do the fucking Great Gatsby.
Yeah, exactly. Like,
come on.
Literally anything all of us at this table read in high school would make more sense than what they picked, you know? Like,
especially since it really has no bearing on the plot because you think, I mean, he does do some quotes.
They do show off. They do quote it a few times in this.
But I'm not. I get what you're saying. They're quotes that are trying to illustrate, like, a mood that's happening with the characters in the movie.
Yeah.
That they get to deliver the lines.
Yeah.
Like, you know, it's like, this is what I'm actually saying to you, but I'm going to say it. And ooh.
Yeah.
Yeah. Bro. Yeah. Exactly.
That might be the laziest version of that. Just screenwriting.
Yeah.
People just quote stuff.
Yeah. Seriously. Yeah. I'm sure that she went and just picked the Bartlett's quotation. But maybe not.
After this movie was released in theaters, like, one of the top most searched things on Google was the Iliad first edition because people were like losing their mind over that. Especially because, like, the book looks like a legit book and it's not a prop book. It is a real book. It is an early printing of the Iliad. But like, for a movie that was, or for a movie, for a epic poem that was told for orally for 3,000 years, and then printed on a scroll, and then went through all these various forms of like translation before it ever even made it to print. It's insane to like be like, I found this for a buck at a garage sale, and like it's the first edition. That's just not plausible.
Yeah. Mm-mm. Well, she ends up having an affair with this guy. Is it fair to say an affair? She has a one night stand.
Once. Like, I feel like this movie, the trailer makes you think it like they have sex all the time.
That's they're what
like,
I was expecting. Yeah.
But they have sex once. In the
they're like having a legit affair. Like they're right, fucking lovers.
Ongoing,
yeah.
Not just once. And then
no, because that was Fatal Attraction, right? They actually had an affair. And then she slowly went like,
I will not be ignored.
Yeah. Then you end up with a rabbit in your stew pot. What was the thing?
That was like over a weekend at least, right? So it was like they fucked all weekend, right?
Yeah.
Because
they were on a trip or something.
Made more sense.
Yeah, but this is the idea. It's the morality. It's the cautionary tale, right? It's like you got to be careful. You know, these moments of inflamed passion can lead to consequences that you have to watch out for, especially
inflamed
passion engorged. Okay, fun.
Engorged. Never again.
Inflamed and engorged.
And engorged.
The STD thing's not. I mean, that's
why
subtext.
I quit the Saturday Night Freak Show.
Subtext is the whole STD thing. But basically, the idea that, you know, this one night of, you know, I'm not thinking about what's happening can come back later to bite you and ruin your life.
To bite you on your prodigious insured ass.
That would have been awesome if that actually happened. Again, we were thinking about like ways you could make this movie better. The only one that it did was nailed an eyeball at the end. But
Were you hoping for a bitten ass? Is that what you just said?
I think so, better?
As Holly and I were saying when we were watching this movie, is that like at this point in the movie when they have sex, like technically nothing wrong is happening. She is separated from her husband, who does not live in the same house as her.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. He is 19 years old, is not a student of hers yet.
20.
Because
he's basically
summer.
20.
He says almost
20. Yeah.
He says almost 20.
He's 20.
Yeah.
It would have been creepier if they cast a younger guy. I think, but maybe
like
you can't do that in a movie.
He looks like he's
maybe
almost
they
30.
Should have just
he's
swapped old. The actors he looks, who played the son and him.
Yeah. Because this guy, that's the thing. I guess
he looks too old.
I think this is the
problem.
It's like
old.
She may be in her 40s, but
she does not
can
look though.
Like she's 20s. He's supposed to be 20, but he looks like he's in his 30s. So to your eye, I don't think you go like.
Yeah.
You don't go like there's something
this is wrong,
wrong
yeah.
with this.
Right. Yeah.
You know?
But like at this point in the movie, he is like pals with her son. So great stepdad setup, right? Like they're best friends. And John Corbett's not really in the picture at this point. And J-Lo's alone and it's summer. So like the school semester has not started yet. So she does not know that this person is going to be a student of hers. Mm-hmm. So like, I feel like this movie wants, like, I remember seeing the trailers for this movie and thinking like, holy shit, this is like, if Blumhouse did the Mary Kay Letourneau story, right? Mm-hmm. But it's not, because this kid's not underage. This kid is living basically on his own next door. There's so many things at play here that make it so different from a Mary Kay Letourneau situation that I feel like it's unfair for them to market it in that way.
It's almost like it missed the opportunity for her to, you know, be pregnant.
He should have just been 17, right?
Yeah, like, he should have been 17. She should have got pregnant and like, what am I going to do with this? Yeah. And, you know. Then he becomes, but like the guy.
Do you think they were afraid to make it like 17? Do you think they were like that?
Yes. Yes.
Because I'm watching this, I'm like, oh, look, two consenting adults having sex.
Right, exactly.
Bravo.
Right.
You're like, I have no problem with this.
I didn't. I'm like, this is fine. Go for it. Both of you.
And you're like, wow, he's really nice to her son. Yeah. Uh-huh. He's like, you know. Yeah.
It should feel awkward. It should feel wrong when they're doing what they're doing.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. Because you have to realize where, you know, it's like she's crossed a moral line.
Yes.
It's really vague in this.
Yeah, the sex wasn't the problem for me. What the problem was he's 20 years old and he's going back to high school.
That's not allowed. You get your GED.
That's right. That's like, where my problem comes
in. I remember going to school, like being in high school, and like you could not bring someone to prom that was older than 19.
Yeah.
Like, so the fact that they would let someone that's 19 come back to school and get their degree makes no fucking sense. You
probably,
just get your GED.
It's the movie making an excuse for having to cast an older because they're afraid to do it as a younger thing, which is what
like,
it probably should have been. Which would have been more exploitive, which would have been more entertaining.
Okay. Yeah. Right. I don't know. My only guess is they want to try and not make Jennifer Lopez.
Unsympathetic.
I guess so. I guess that's why they would make
him older. They don't want her to make her a predator. Like,
right, they don't
want
to make her one of the stories of the teacher having sex with the student that you see everywhere. Mm-hmm. So that's why they would cast
But then,
older.
Like, why not? Why not make it, like, why not just make it college then, right? And make her a college professor and make him, like, a freshman, you know?
Yeah. Something.
So, like, it's still of age, but it's still a little taboo because there is still the power dynamic of a teacher and a student where, like, where the teacher still has control over the student in that sense. Like, why even set it in high school? At that point, because then you have to do the mental gymnastics of like, oh, he's 19, but he has to go back to high school. Just make it college, make it a fucking community college, if nothing else,
or add some other elements. Like, she has sex with him, and then she finds out that he's like somebody she knows, son.
Ooh,
like, see, that adds an extra element to it.
I've got a movie for you.
I was gonna say, there's a movie.
I've got a movie.
Yes,
John, you should watch the movie Adore if you have not seen it.
Adore. Yes,
Robin Wright Penn and Naomi Watts fuck each other's sons.
Sean's face right now.
Sean's face is priceless right now, audience.
He is such a bewilderment.
That's a hell of a log.
Like, I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing.
I don't know. I want to know like how it happened. Don't tell me. I want to know.
It's set in beautiful Australian beaches too.
This is relatively recent.
Yeah, it's like maybe 2 or 3 years old.
Sean is just
an accident, or if they do it on purpose, or one does it and the other one does it for revenge.
You'll have to watch the trailer and see the movie.
And it's shot like a tourism commercial for Australia. It is so beautifully shot.
So Chris Hemsworth just shows up randomly?
Yeah. It is like, wow, the ocean is beautiful. They live in these amazing beach houses, and Naomi Watts and Reverend Wright Penn are doing amazing work, as always. You know? And
interesting.
The two sons are, I think, relatively unknown actors, but check it out. I think it's on Netflix still.
Alrighty.
It was on Netflix when I watched it like a month ago, so.
There you go.
This is my pick in 2 weeks.
Yeah. Adore.
Well, this movie that we watched, The Boy Next Door, has an efficiency of a setup where everything that's set up in the first 20 minutes pays off in the last 20 minutes. The son has an asthma or an allergy condition.
Oh, God.
The gun and the
EpiPen.
Yeah, the son, the gun, and the EpiPen, and the bullies. Because as soon as you as soon as you're introduced to every single character,
like, you know what's going to happen to them.
Yeah.
Like, oh, I know, I can see how this is going to come back to
like,
you.
Oh, I see how this movie's. It's like it's one of those things where you see the character introduced and you can see like where the third act goes.
Each
character is introduced in the first 20 minutes, you're filling in the last 20 minutes.
Yep.
And then,
yeah.
I mean, it really was like, huh? Yep. There's the bullies. I know what's going to happen to them. Oh, there's Kristen Chenoweth. I know what's going to happen to her. Oh, there, it was like, bam, the whole way through it. I don't know if that's just me, but
it's
kind of how it was filling in.
Yeah.
Did you pick up on Chekhov's engine hanging from the rafters of a barn? Because that was the opening scene of the movie.
I know. I didn't see
when
that.
When her and Kristen Chenoweth are walking through the barn talking about like her husband cheating on her, you see the engine hanging from the ceiling. It's like a big above shot. They really highlight it.
I saw it, I was like, huh, who lives in this fucking place? Yeah. But it should have been by economy of sets that engine is going to come back sooner or later.
Why would you ever?
Why was it suspended?
You pull it out of the
all the way up to the top of the barn.
And you leave it there.
Well, they don't have a car there, so they apparently...
That's the thing. You pull it out and then you leave it.
He's going to bring it. Yeah, who's working on it? Her ex-husband or something. I don't know. Like, what?
We don't know.
Basically, it's a movie where she regrets immediately what she's done. Her husband comes back, and they're trying to get a family thing together. And so then the movie becomes an exercise in suspense. At least, this is what it's intended. Suspense, where... the kid keeps on ratcheting up the leverage that he has on her, right? I know that we did this thing.
Leverage, like he thought ahead in ways that are disturbing. Mm-hmm. Like the fact that he like had cameras set up in his house just in case I happened to fuck the lady next door that will probably be my teacher.
Seems
like he was thinking very far ahead.
Yeah.
They could have called us. I know what you did last night. He could have started sending her notes and shit.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
because like at the point he fucked her. She wasn't his teacher yet.
Yeah.
Right.
And he still thought ahead to be like, I should record this in case.
Right. I should set up this really shitty camera.
Terrible, right?
Maybe he does that with all of his girlfriends, though. I mean, maybe this is just his thing.
It's possible.
I love the way in these movies, and I know that it's intended to be this way, because the idea is that you can't judge a book by its cover, and beware, everybody, that everyone else out there, you don't know what kind of psycho crazy person is hiding behind that facade.
Mm-hmm.
But they seem completely well-adjusted. At the beginning, And then
that's how sociopaths work.
And then it turns out that like they're really way off the rails with their rage and just they're demented and they're like not seeing the world in a real way at all. But maybe it's because they get twisted by their, this is the first time, like when we were watching Fear, that the first time they're experiencing emotions, they don't know how to deal with it and it fucks them all up. And then that warps their version of or vision of the world.
I would say so. Yeah. Cause he gets kind of set off when things don't start not going his way. When she's like, no, this was a mistake.
She's punching the wall. He's punching the wall. Yeah. He's
he punched the wall immediately. Yeah. Like immediately. Yeah. Like that should have been like a, like,
he's like, oh, he's violent. This is going to come in later.
It's like, I think Fear had more subtlety and it's build up to like Marky Mark's insanity than this movie. Lot. Like he punched a wall Fear immediately. Had
more subtlety.
Yeah. That's saying. It did.
You might be right.
It did though.
Might be right.
Like, okay, you have sex with someone and immediately afterwards they punch a wall and you're not being like, I need to never speak to this person again.
No, that's not good.
Like, yeah.
No, there was so many moments in this
movie.
Unless they're
like,
where,
it was so damn good.
There was so many fucking moments in this movie where I'm like, Jayla, why is she not leaving? Like, why is she not running and
calling
cops?
But
he's
right next door, Holly. That's the point. He's right next door.
But isn't that...
It's in the title!
Isn't that the... But this is what is supposed to be what's fun about these movies, right? As you watch these people do things that you wouldn't do. Or maybe, I don't know, is that what's fun about it? You sit there going like, well, I would do this right now. And then they don't do it. And you go, no! And then they end up paying the consequence for their bad decisions. Mm-hmm. You're watching them
it
make
makes
bad
you smarter
decisions.
Than the characters.
But it's,
it makes you feel good about yourself.
I know, but it's even like so much as like when he's got her trapped in the bathroom at the school dance, and he's
and
literally
the eye fucked Claire Peterson on the wall.
Yeah, the graffiti on the wall. He's literally like trying to rape her in the bathroom. She finally like nails him between the legs. And she doesn't turn and run. She instead stands there and just like threatening him. Like, no,
run away.
Fucking, he attacked you in the bathroom. You turn and you run.
I don't think she's even perceiving it as that, though. I think she's just like, I need to like express how I feel right now.
Oh,
and like,
honey, we're
I
know, that.
Right. I'm saying like, it's not a rational thing. Like, right. It's not a rational train of thought. It's, I can control the situation if I just explain myself.
Why do you have your hand up?
Because he has a question.
Oh, okay.
I didn't want to just jump in there.
Because being polite. She's a teacher, he's doing the theme thing. Yes, Sean.
Oh, yeah, there's the whole, it carried over.
Yeah, okay. Mr. Tyler, you go ahead. Yeah.
Jesus, all right, I need a second after that. What?
It was like PTSD it's moment. Like, that's what you need.
No, I'm out of high school. I'm fine.
No,
fine.
I did my homework.
I'm a well-adjusted adult. The graffiti in the bathroom.
Yeah.
What happened to that? Because that's still up there as far as I'm concerned. Yeah. Like, somebody would have discovered that the next day. She didn't go in there and take it down.
As we saw, there was only, like, 10 people at this dance total. So that's I'm assuming no one saw it.
Yeah, because somebody would have had some questions. Like, oh, we found this in the
bathroom. There are no extras in this movie.
We have some questions.
Yeah, there's all those near close calls with really, like you're on the edge of your seat.
The faxed pictures.
Yeah.
Like, that part actually stresses me out. Because, like... Like that is like a trope of this genre of movies, right? Is like these pictures just keep coming and you can't stop them from coming, right?
Yeah.
And like, granted, it's kind of like a dated way they're delivered in this movie in the sense that it's like these horrible black and white faxed images where you can't even tell it's her. Mm-hmm. But like the fact that they're strung up like from both sides of her classroom and several, like there had to have been thousands of those pictures in her room, right? Because the whole floor was covered.
It was hundreds.
The whole floor
for
was covered,
sure.
And then there was like several rows on the ceiling.
Yeah,
and like. I don't know, the stress of like her trying to tear them all down and stuff them in the garbage and stuff them under her desk before her class came in. I was like, I feel, I like, I can't.
It worked.
I was like, I feel the anxiety right now.
Because we're just it's just not going to work.
Yeah.
This isn't going to go well.
There's no way it makes sense.
It would have, should not have worked.
Which I think is why you're sitting there going like, well, at this point, this is never going to work. And what are you going to have to do? But the movie is like, no, somehow she magically gathers them all up and shoves them underneath her desk before the students come into the room. I'm like, okay, it's like the crabs and I Know What You Did Last Summer. Get those things out of there.
Yeah. But how, missed opportunity. How great would it have been if the principal came in and is talking to her and talking like kind of like giving her shit about how like she needs to start her class on time, right? And she's just very distracted and she's like, yeah, okay, sure, whatever, right? And she's looking down and there's like one picture stuck to the bottom of a shoe, right?
Yeah.
And she's just like freaking out, being like, just don't look down. Yeah. You know? And he's like, and you know, just don't let this happen again, right? And he turns around and walks out, and then she's like, oh fuck, and she takes it off the ground. You know, like,
yeah,
how great of like a tension building scene would that have been if there was like one she missed,
yeah,
right?
Yeah. Or even better if it got like stuck to the bottom of his shoe and she had to just slowly just step on it, like, as he was leaving,
yeah,
just to make sure it didn't go with him. Yeah. Or not, yeah, or just
if
to,
she
like,
had to like get all seductive
over
and like get like up in his grill and be like, well, you know,
I think that's just, that'll just make her
I'm
case
really
worse.
Sorry, yeah, I was like, that's
like,
not gonna help
that's
her.
Not gonna help her at
but
all.
Like, that's how these movies work though, right? Mm-hmm. Well, that's her weapon, so she has to use it, right? Sure. You know,
but just add a little more tension.
This is the kind of movie, those are the kind of what you're talking about. It's like, this is the stuff that Brian De Palma and Alfred Hitchcock, like, they do in their sleep,
yeah,
so much better, I think, than it was done here. I mean, if it's producing tension, then it's the desired effect. But like you're saying, you could have made it better. It could have been done better.
That would
have elevated.
Probably given me a panic attack if that scene actually, if I had watched that actual scene happen of like her constantly looking down and then like meeting his gaze of being like, oh shit, don't look down.
It's like, we know it's there, but like,
And like, I feel like we've seen that done a million times. So why not go for it in this? Like, what would have cost you to add that, you know?
Yeah,
you might have had to pay that actor a little bit more to stand there for a little longer. Like,
I don't know. I don't know that they were clever enough to think of it.
Yeah, because I mean, you got to ask, like, what's Cohen's goal with this? I mean, he's just basically, it feels like, and this is the case with most of the movies that he does, he's just basically taking the script and like, I got to put that on the screen. Like, there's no kind of, you know, it's not filtered through a personality or like how I would do it.
Yeah, he's not an auteur. That's not his thing. It's not his bag. Would it surprise you guys if I told you this was written by someone that never written a movie before?
Barbara.
Shocking. Barbara Curry.
Yeah.
She's a lawyer.
Okay.
Yeah.
Hey, man, sometimes you need entertainment lawyers. She, a script in there every now and again.
She's a criminal justice lawyer that she had like found her dream house in L.A. and really wanted to move in and found out, like, the house directly across the street was like her son's biggest bully at school, and so she was like,
well, so she fucked him.
So she was like, she was like, well, we can't buy this house because like my kid's life will be hell, basically.
Yeah.
And then she was like, well, what if I write a movie about like this bully coming between me and my son? And then that kind of evolved into this movie, which.
She didn't write a movie about a bully coming between her son. Yeah. She wrote a movie about a fucking the guy next door.
Well, but like, that's what makes me think at one point in time, the script was supposed to be about like a 16, 17 year old. And then like, it didn't test well, or the studio was like, we're not fucking doing that.
Yeah.
It's like, we want this to actually get seen by people.
Right.
Let's make it sense.
Yeah.
With J-Lo in it.
Well, it leads to the obligatory for the genre, I think, or maybe this is the thing that elevates it above the Lifetime movie, is the overblown climax in the flaming barn where everything's on fire. The husband's strung up and the kid's like, because look, this comes out of out of nowhere, because you're skipping like good scenes where like the husband, as far as we know, does not know at the end of the movie when he's being taken away.
What the fuck
is
happening?
Yeah, he
does not know that she fucked the kid next door.
Yep. He has no idea why he's being abducted and tortured.
Basically. No idea.
Yeah.
And the son doesn't either. So in
which
our
was the
mind,
alternate title for this movie, I Fuck the Kid Next Door.
J-Lo fucks the kid next door.
I'd watch that
movie. Yeah, right. Yeah. It's like, I'm all right.
But does this morally allow J-Lo like some kind of, she's still the hero of the movie somehow, because like nobody, like her family is still going to survive, you know, from what we've seen, because they don't know what happened.
Well, yeah, because the only person that knows is Kristen Chenoweth, and she's dead.
And so. She's dead. Yeah.
Yeah.
So she can say whatever she wants. Like, the fucking kid's crazy. I don't know. He's crazy.
That's very true.
He's just a psychopath.
And, you know, they do, but they don't have evidence that, like, you know, she goes to visit, like, that burnt out husk of a van that was, like, his parents' van, you know, and, like, basically, like, that was, like, the setup for, like, he's always kind of been crazy, you know?
Did I miss why he killed his parents?
Because his dad was cheating on his mom. He doesn't like adulterers. That's his whole thing.
That was the thing?
Yeah. Because remember they said, like, oh, the driver was distracted, and they showed, like, cut of, like, that girl pulling her skirt up?
Yeah, I remember that scene, but I thought that was just his
parents. That was not his parents.
I thought that was his parents.
Dad and the mistress.
Okay.
Mom killed herself.
Yeah.
All right. I missed that. It's deep.
It's deep. It's very deep. Yeah. The background.
You guys just don't get the layers to this movie, okay? Layers.
It's true. I didn't.
You know, if you go deep enough, you're just sitting in a hole. And I think, I think that might be this movie.
What was the son allergic to?
I think he had a variety of allergies. I think dust was one of them.
And boxing?
Well, because like, just yeah, well, no, I think the boxing just is like the dust coming out of the bag is what it was.
I thought it was the exertion. You may be right. So I don't know.
Allergies?
Because this is what we're told. He has allergies, right?
Did you look at this kid? Explicitly say that's
what it is.
You can't have an allergic reaction to exertion.
This kid could.
That's called asthma. That's different.
But I wonder if that's what it was. They were taking him to an allergist. That's what I'm
saying. Put the kid from Breaking Bad in. It makes so much more sense.
You don't use an EpiPen when you're having an asthma attack.
That's what I'm saying. It's got to be dust or something, right? Or like latex or something like that.
So maybe it doesn't make any damn sense.
They should have fucking said that.
Where we don't know, it doesn't make sense, and it's convenient to the plot of the
Well,
movie.
This is the I other...
They never explicitly say what he's allergic to. They just say he's allergies and he has an EpiPen. That's all they say.
Yeah.
What does it help? What does it do for the plot of the movie? Does it
It's bond? Chekhov's EpiPen. What are you talking about, man?
But does it bond the two so that he's more likely to take Noah's side when Noah starts telling him shit because he saved his life?
I think it's more like he's his protector.
Well, right, but it bonds them more, because you saved my life. So
yeah, because then Noah becomes more in a position of like, I suppose the brother figure or the father figure.
Here's my thing.
This is what we do with the middle. I said the first 20 minutes sets up the last 20 minutes. In the middle, we have the dynamic where Noah, the evil kid, tries to turn the family members against J-Lo.
Here's the fucking thing, though. It's his only goddamn friend. They don't need all these bonding moments. It's his only friend.
They do because they need the whole family to trust him. Like that, they need everyone to because then it makes J-Lo the crazy person. If everyone else around her trusts him, then it makes J-Lo the crazy person.
They don't even use that, though.
Yeah.
I agree that that's what they would do, but they don't go that far.
Right,
they don't make J-Lo crazy. I think this is like they're afraid to in this movie. She's the good one, and they don't want the audience turning against her at any point.
It's playing it safe. You're right.
It's playing it safe. It doesn't go to those extremes where it could.
Yeah.
They don't want to make her crazy. I mean, they could.
Because she always deals with things in a way that she never really seems to fly off the hook. Like, there was times when he was talking to her, and I'm like, fuck, I wouldn't react the calm way that she is right now.
Yeah.
Like,
exactly.
It's kind of like she's like, it'll be fine. It'll be fine.
Yeah.
She's like, no.
After this, I'm going to figure out how to deal with this.
Yeah.
Maybe not right now, but afterwards. But after he, okay, now he's got a knife, but don't worry. I'll be able to figure this out later.
we've all been through that.
Yeah, but so he basically spends time getting the son to think, you know, that the father is, you know, like, you know, like the way I guess that he thinks about his parents, that the father's a cheating guy, deserves to die, screwed up the family, and so we have some scenes in the. I guess that's the main plot of the middle of the movie, right? Is J-Lo's family going to survive the influence of Noah, the intruder, the usurper?
And ultimately, we don't know.
Did you guys feel like that they set up that the garage door was going to like kill someone in the first act? Because
I thought it might.
Like the way it wasn't working, and she's like, "I can't hold it up." And then like he came and helped. I was like, "Oh, he's going to fuck up the garage door, make it like chop someone's head off or something."
Yeah.
Right? Like,
yeah,
a better movie.
Nope. It's called Scream 4.
Well, we
where it crushed her back.
In the big flaming barn fire finale,
the big flaming end,
we do have the grand guignol moment where,
if you will,
fancy, huh?
Where she does use Chekhov's EpiPen.
Yep.
And
to
it looks
stab
good.
Duder in the eye.
Right in the eye.
Yeah, it's like the one moment that it actually gave us what we wanted.
Yeah, because we and
only
this is the thing,
did it better.
But talking about like the way this movie was predictable, sat there right before this happened and going like, well, she's gonna stab with it. Like, no, she's gonna stab him in the eye with it.
Yeah.
And sure enough, she stabs him in the eye.
Yeah.
Then it has the Fulci moment with the close up of her jabbing her finger into the socket.
Yeah. Leaking and the pus and stuff.
Like, yeah, it's rated R.
Yeah, liquefied eyeballs. Mm-hmm. Bring it on.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's as bad as it gets, because I mean Kristen Chenoweth gets beat up and she eventually ends up dead.
That was kind of bizarre.
It
happened off
out
screen.
Ceiling?
It was a closet.
Yeah, your closet.
I think she was going upstairs and it was like a closet, like on a stairway.
Right.
But like it looked like she dropped from the ceiling. The way
it was odd.
It was
odd.
It made no sense.
Tiny, tiny person.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was odd.
Yeah. Yeah. But none of
and his reason for killing her makes no sense.
That's true.
I killed her in case she wasn't your friend. I find no fault in that.
Yeah, he's a psycho. Yeah. He's lost, but we can't try.
But
to
then, by
get
logic,
in the mind of a psycho.
The whole family
crazy.
Before. Everyone, yeah, why everyone. Did he bother keeping the family alive?
Now I agree with you on this. There should have been more murder in this.
Yeah,
movie.
Yeah, yeah. I don't understand
he has
why.
No problem murdering.
Like the scene,
her.
And we all were very confused by the scene when it's panning out and he's talking to Kristen Chenoweth, and we find out she's actually still alive, sitting there listening to him.
This is where you pan out and her head's on.
Exactly.
Yeah. Like, this is what that.
Because then,
doing.
Like when he calls J Lo, he.
That's
uses...
a zoom out, by the way. Thank you very much.
Well, yeah, yeah. I'm sorry.
It's a zoom out. I'm sorry. Yeah.
I hate when people do that. Yeah. I apologize for doing it right now.
Sorry. Because then he called. Yeah. Did you say the sorry. Pull out?
Yeah. Well, it's called a pull out.
It is a pull out. But yeah, okay.
Yes. It doesn't only mean one thing, Holly.
I'm sorry. No, whatever. Whatever. Whatever.
Push in, pull out. That's how it works.
That is how it works. You are very correct.
You learn something every day when you listen to this. Now you can go make your own movie. I'm sorry, Holly. You were going somewhere.
We're
going to
teach you things, guys.
Was I? I don't fucking remember.
You will learn some shit.
It pulls out.
Continue.
No, I have no idea what I was saying.
The camera backs off. And it takes a very fucking long time to get from this
and
close-up.
And he's not a good monologuer, so it doesn't work.
No.
Yeah. But the whole point was he still used a recording of her on the phone. So there was literally no reason for her to be alive in that moment.
No, and she died, and she's dead after this scene. She should be dead in this scene.
She should be dead in this scene.
It makes it him crazier if he's talking to a dead body.
Yes.
Why? It's a rated R movie from Blumhouse. She should be dead.
Yes. I gotta wonder if it's a contractual thing.
If for no other
thing.
Reason than she's Kristen Chenoweth.
I gotta wonder if it's a contractual thing of like, I need to be in this many minutes of the movie.
Maybe.
Kind of thing.
That's
you know?
Quite possible.
I feel like that would make the most sense, but I feel like I'm giving it a lot of credit by assuming that.
You might be. Mm-hmm. But she's dead in the next scene. Mm-hmm.
I know. Like, it was such
off
a wasted
screen.
Moment. Such a wasted moment.
He doesn't even pick up the wrench that is sitting on the table and be like, and like just before he hits her, cut away. Like, nothing like that.
What's this guy done before or after? What's his name?
Brian Guzman.
Yeah.
Heroes Reborn. Pretty Little Liars. Lots of TV.
Then anonymity, I hope. Cause,
lots of TV.
I mean, he's capable at like being, you know, a modern day actor.
The problem that Holly and I were talking about, and I could not tell you what this guy looks like, because in every scene
he looks different.
No matter how it's lit, he looks like a completely different person.
Yeah,
his face looks completely different, no matter how it's lit. I don't know what he looks like.
No.
Don't give him credit, Sean. God damn it. No.
Should we give him credit?
No.
No? Okay.
Like, I don't know if maybe his profile's just that much different.
I blame reshoots and low budget.
I think when we noticed the change, everything else had been shot on the other side of his face.
But that's weird if he looks that different from
the morning after, everything was being shot on the other side of his face. Maybe that's why.
I don't know.
I have no idea.
If that's a choice, that's genius. But if it's just the product of cheap filmmaking, not great.
I don't think we'll ever know.
Yeah. No, we won't.
That's okay.
Not when the scholars go back and the decades of research into The Boy Next Door take place.
Yeah, when we get our first edition of The Boy Next Door. If there was a special
edition
of this movie, it would be cool.
First edition!
Oh,
my God. Screen Factory.
Someone Photoshop.
No one will buy it, but you should put it out, please.
I'll buy it. I'll fucking buy it.
Right.
Do you own it right now, Michaela?
No, I don't, but I'll buy a first edition. It better be $1.
First edition of The Boy Next Door for $1.
At a yard sale.
Do you hear these ideas? This gold that we are spewing right now?
The best choice Kevin, the son, made in this movie, which, okay, I could not stop making the we need to talk about Kevin trope.
Yeah. I mean,
it was too easy. But the best choice he made in this movie was when he put potato chips in a sandwich.
Hands down. That was the best character choice.
Hands down.
I don't know whose choice that was.
Like, you know what? This boy might be smart.
But
he might
like
be going places.
Oh, I don't know. I'm pretty sure I would have been like, I don't think he's going to make it. Just as a human being, I don't like it's God saying something to us because he almost died in gym.
Boxing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Which. Oh, God. Never. I can't even.
Yeah, no, like he had veins on his face. He was about to die.
Oh,
yeah.
Like, to die.
The makeup
he went
was
from
severe.
Like, yeah. Yeah, I thought that. It was like, what? It's like every blood vessel in his face is bursting right now.
He dropped. He dropped his computer class to take up boxing because you can drop computer and take up a sport.
So, you know, in the okay. I think it's X-Men 2. when Rogue like uses her power when Wolverine stabs her to like save herself, right? Yeah, and like you see all the veins kind of come to the surface on Wolverine and it looks like he's about to die.
Yeah.
That's what he looks like when he has that fucking reaction to that boxing
Life sucked out of him.
Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah. He's got the real dark circles under his eyes and really like severe makeup.
A little more bloated corpse than Hugh Jackman, but yeah, I see where you're going.
It's more like in Starship Troopers when the guy gets the thing in the top of his head. His brain sucked out.
It's like, yeah. That's a good moment.
This was not that good.
All right, well,
what happens at the end?
It just didn't earn it. That's what it was. He was boxing and all of a sudden he was like a sucked out corpse for no reason.
Yeah, there's just things in this movie that are not earned. And we're just like, okay.
Yeah.
Like and we like and your we, ending.
Can I request a small reenactment with you?
here we go.
We completely missed the cookies scene entirely. The I love your mother's cookies.
Oh, I'm missing something here. What do you mean?
You miss that scene
It's we had a storm the other night.
It got real wet up here. Ryan Guzman says it got real wet up here and looks at J Lo and like, you got real wet up here, basically.
I made some cookies.
And then
love your mother's cookies.
Kevin, we need to talk about. Kevin says, "Do you want to take some cookies for the road?" And Ryan Guzman says, "I love your mother's cookies."
that's right.
I know.
And then he gives that little look.
It's like gross. The poetry and the dialogue.
The music of the scene.
That's what I'm going for.
Were.
Yeah, is brilliant. Overpowering.
It makes you shiver. Yeah, you're like,
it does.
Gross.
It is one of those scenes where whether they were trying to do it or not, you're just like, no, don't like it. Stop making me feel this way.
I don't like it.
It's extra gross because the sun is oblivious to the like.
Yeah,
gross.
That kid's so dumb.
Yeah.
Why don't you like him, Mom?
We didn't even talk about the fact that he fucks his school dance date, whatever.
We have to have the nudity quotient because I was told at the beginning of the movie there was nudity and J-Lo's got her boobs, nipples covered during the boob grab.
Yep.
So we get, she is the bonus.
The hardware store girl.
Yep.
She's like full frontal and like why does she like run across the room into a blowjob? Why did that happen? Like, she was like, she was, why was that choreographed that way?
That doesn't happen.
That's what I was going to say. This isn't the way that you do it.
She's like, how this works. So there's like a whole wall of windows, right? And she's like in the farthest window, and he's like sitting on the bed on the other farthest window. And like, you see like almost like stop motion, like of her running across into a blowjob. It was strange.
It's odd.
Yeah, it was really weird.
But not unheard of. Am I right? No, okay. So.
I don't know.
Listener, tell us if that's normal.
Please write in.
We are going to get so many stories.
If you need a running start on a blowjob, please tell us.
The year I ran the first blowjob.
Yeah.
Like, she was the only full frontal in this movie, right?
Yeah.
Hardware store girl?
Wait, you're saying full frontal, but I don't remember, like, full frontal.
Before she crouched down, you saw it from a distance. It wasn't close up, but it was like from J-Lo's window. But she like stood up, like, and then went down into the fucking blowjob. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I should have seen that.
Yeah.
All right. So,
Colin's like, I thought this movie rented for
Colin's
3 days.
Like,
that's right. Now I can go back.
You've got it for like 36 hours.
Who needs a Mr. Skin subscription when you've got Amazon Prime?
Wait, Mr. Well, hold on. I thought Mr. Skin was just like a database.
Dr. Skin?
It's a subscription.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Pay for
you have to pay for that shit?
Oh, yeah. You got to pay for that shit.
He's not doing it for the love of doing it.
Don't they have the clips?
No, I thought like Mr. Skin, told you at the timestamp of when it started.
Oh, maybe. I thought it had the clips, but I could be wrong.
They have the clips. I don't want to go into this too much.
You're like, if I admit that I know, then I know.
Sean's a premium subscriber on Mr. Skin.
It's only $99 for the entire year, okay?
And I just did the free trial for a week.
All right, I don't want to sound creepy. I don't.
I know
they have the clips on there. But you do have to pay for it. Oh, yeah, they have the clips.
I thought it was just like a Wikipedia of like timestamps.
I think it maybe used to be.
That's what I thought it I mean, but, I guess I don't, I've never been
I'm
to the website.
I'm pretty sure they have the clips on there.
That's what I thought.
I'm absolutely sure they have the clips on there.
Is there like a Mrs. Skin that's like like the female equivalent? Like,
right, well, I would assume they just put it all under the one thing.
Is he married? Is Mr. Skin married?
if not, this is it's a revenue generator.
I don't know why I've never heard someone think of this before, but this seems like Mrs. an obvious Skin, question. Yeah. Is there a Mrs. Skin?
Ms. Skin.
Mrs. If they're married, it's a partnership.
It's not play woman, it's play girl. Ms. Okay, so before this gets out of control,
it's all right. It's too late.
Yeah, it's true.
Too late.
Let's be honest. There's going to be less material on Mrs. Skin.
I mean, it's going to be a lot of Harvey Keitel. And that's
a lot of Harvey Keitel. A lot of
and Willem Dafoe.
No, what's his name?
Viggo Mortensen.
Fassbender.
And Viggo Mortensen.
Kevin Bacon.
A little Bruce Willis somewhere in there, I think.
Yeah. Oh my God. The Color of Darkness.
Color of Night. Yeah, a little Ben Affleck in there.
Yeah, whatever. That Ben Affleck.
I said a half a second of Ben Affleck.
Ben Affleck McGregor. Was overblown for Gone Girl. There was
pun intended.
Nothing.
Yeah, I was gonna say that man has been overblown. I guarantee it. It's unfortunate.
On that note.
We should probably.
We're too much tonight.
Yeah. What? I got three beers in front of me, so I have an excuse. So.
He also doesn't know how to count. He's got four in front of him.
Oh, well, three empties. All right. I am going to hail. Igor, bring us the mail.
Masters, the mail. I've got the mail. So many letters. Our followers are rising.
Thank you, Igor.
Igor, have you ever been overblown?
He's got a tray of cookies.
he's sniffing them. Stop.
He's sniffing them. Don't eat those cookies, guys.
No one eat those.
I was waiting for something to be up with those goddamn cookies in the movie. Never happened. Nope. All right. So thank you for writing in, the folks who I'm about to read. And we should remind people that they can get a hold of us on Facebook.
Facebook.com/SaturdayNightFreakShow.
On the Twitter that exists.
It's at Freak Show. It does exist.
By email.
SaturdayNightFreakShow@yahoo.com.
We're on Instagram at SaturdayNightFreakShow. Nick Hammond writes in and says, uh-oh, we're going down this rabbit hole again about the choice of the boy next door.
What the fuck does that mean?
I think it means
the rabbit hole, like the sexy thriller rabbit hole.
He's like, there used to be people who picked
former members of the show
who Woody Allen movies, and then there was
fun of your pick,
Home Alone and The Princess Bride.
But I don't think he's seen this movie.
That all predates me, so I don't know anything about that.
That's very true.
Those
who don't know the past.
Catriel Tyson Rodriguez, I hope I'm saying your name right, writes in and says, I'm 90% sure I fell asleep watching this.
Oh, this is your sister, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Ashley Wine writes in and says, I have so many opinions about this movie and none of them are good.
What are they?
But I want to know more.
Yeah, tell me more.
And now we're intrigued, like Ashley.
Yeah, but I want
a thesis,
something.
Hose Be Trippin' writes in and says,
Instagram name ever.
This and Obsessed.
I hope his Instagram is just women tripping on things and falling over.
The thing that's great is his name is Jose, so it's Hose, like Jose Be Trippin'. Like, it's genius because it's Hose Be Trippin', but like as in Jose.
Gotcha.
With a J.
Bravo.
Mr. Hose writes in and says, Mr. Be Trippin'. Mr. Trippin writes in and says, this and Obsessed trademark. I like the fact that you used the trademark logo or emblem in here. This and Obsessed with Idris Elba back to back.
Mm-hmm. Beautiful.
It doesn't finish that thought.
Yeah, no, I'm with you.
I went off
to be alone and watch those movies.
I suppose.
I'm hoping to add Unforgettable to that and make it like a triple feature.
I think it's no good. You got to see No Good Deed. That's the one where he's like the escaped convict.
But that's not more of like that's not a relationship dynamic. Whereas Unforgettable's like Katherine Heigl's like the scorned ex-wife and like Rosario Dawson's the new girl in town. You know, then she's dating the guy. So it's like.
You really do have a thing for this genre.
Yeah, no, it's. It checks a couple boxes that I'm here for. So.
All right. Well, about our episode.
I'm open to No Good Deed.
The boxes that we check.
Yeah. Skin subscription box that we check.
Uh-huh.
I've never
$99 a year. So about our episode, Hercules. Andrew John writes in about Hercules and says, you guys sold me on this one by the crazy pictures you posted alone. I have to see if I can rent it, then listen to you. I hope it's worth it.
Thanks.
You should totally listen to us.
I think you should watch it and then listen to us so you know what we're talking about.
Hopefully by now, you've seen it and listened to us.
Yes.
And you can tell us what you thought.
And tell
and we'll read it on next week's episode.
That's right. That's right.
Tell other people.
Dom Cree writes in and says,
Dom.
Yeah, welcome back.
Oh, yeah, Dom.
Yeah.
What up?
Hi, Dom.
Dom says, okay, then, in response to your discussion on this episode, Hulkamania, on the Hercules episode, Hulkamania first emerged in 1984.
Thank you. I'm not a Hulkamania expert.
Yeah.
I did learn this in the middle of the podcast. There was not a place to bring it back up, but yes. Yeah.
Although, I don't think that we mentioned, did we mention that Hulk Hogan was in Rocky, was it two?
Yes.
Three.
Mm-hmm. He did mention it. Okay.
Yes. I don't claim to be a wrestling expert, so please correct me.
There you go. Well, he did. He emerged in 1984, and I want to know which of Hulk's movies is most likely to ever be reviewed on the Freak Show, Saturday Night Freak Show.
Suburban Commando.
No Holds Barred is a work of beauty.
Yeah.
In the canon of wrestling movies.
Yeah.
No Holds
Barred. Three Ninjas at the Mountain. They're at,
Mega Mountain.
Or it's some mountain where it's part of an amusement park.
I'll go easy on you, Dom. I think it's Gremlins 2.
Oh, he's not in that
movie. Yeah, come on.
Isn't he also not in a cut of that movie? Isn't there somebody else?
I think if you watch the TV version, it's John Wayne.
Yeah, it's John Wayne in that one. Yeah.
Mr. Nanny's a runner-up.
Suburban Commando. That's all I'm saying. It's got Christopher Lloyd as well.
Well, okay. I guess that means that it's time now to go around the room and find out what we all thought of tonight's movie.
Colin, what did you think about The Boy Next Door?
Oh, I was going to say, Sean, do you know what we watched tonight? Because that seems to be a trend now.
I know. I got this one.
What do we watch?
The movie
that we viewed tonight in your basement on this screen tonight. I got it tonight.
I don't know. What can you say about The Boy Next Door? It's,
what can you say?
I don't really think that it's erotic thriller. I mean, it wasn't terribly erotic beyond
that one scene.
Yeah, there's one scene. There's a sex scene in a movie.
Well, there's some J-Lo.
Yeah, but
I was in for the J-Lo outfits. That was...
Yeah, but this is more. I mean, this is by the stuff that I guess I gauge the erotic thriller by. This is pretty tame. It's very. It's. I mean, I'm surprised that it actually has nudity in it and it has gore. So it's like, okay, at least there's a little. Well, I mean, the eyeball poking.
You know,
it's like there's something they're kind of trying to peek it up above like a PG-13 movie or like a TV made for TV movie. It's widescreen.
All it takes.
I think Jennifer Lopez is a better actress than this movie. It's unfortunate that her career has gotten to the point where this is the stuff that she has to take, wants to take, feels like I don't want to do anything really that taxing, but I'll do this. But she does give it her all. I mean, she's a good, I believe.
She does TV now.
A lot of stuff that she does in this movie. Pardon me. I was going to say that I believe her in this movie, but I just told you that I don't in some of the scenes, so I can't contradict myself. She's good in a lot of it. The kid, I thought was, I don't know. I didn't believe him at all, but I don't know if that's the writing or it's the actor. I mean, I don't think that he's necessarily a bad actor. He's just not a good actor. He's never going to, I think,
Noah.
I don't think he's going to have a career. And the director, I mean, this is on the decline, I think, of a director who I believe, got lucky a bunch of times and doing stuff that people wanted to see, but left to his own devices. Now he's kind of on his way out to the pasture, and that's direct to video, The Hurricane Heist. I've never really liked Rob Cohen.
Nor should you.
Yeah.
He hasn't earned it.
Alex Cross showed it. That guy cannot direct actors. Maybe he's okay. I mean, I like The Fast and Furious for what it is. Yeah. I like XXX even for what it is, the first one. Yeah. I like Dragonheart and Dragon the Bruce Lee Story. I think those are probably the Rob Cohen movies that I like. I don't think I own any of them.
They're not movies that you own.
Yeah.
I own Tomb of the Dragon Emperor by accident.
You've got a box set or something.
Yeah, I had to have it. Yeah. I'd give the disc away right now.
I guess my problem with this movie is I was bored in the middle of it because it was a case of seeing everything set up in the first 20 minutes and knowing how it was going to pay off at the end. I recognize I love genres like slasher films where that exact same thing happens. But somehow I love how we get there, you know, the journey. Well,
they make it more entertaining in the middle.
Because of, I think it's a lot of, it's like if you have exploitation elements in it, that's how you, you know, add the special sauce to your movie. If you're going to play it safe and be like this vanilla Hollywood thing, well, it's not really taking any chances, as we said. It's kind of playing it safe down the middle. It's like, this is safe so everybody can go see it and go like, yeah, okay, woo, it was exciting for the night, and then you're done.
Yeah.
And I think that's all it's supposed to be. Does it succeed at that? I mean, I don't know. It's not a horrible movie. I just don't have any reason why I would recommend it to you when there's so many, it feels like, better movies that you should see if you want like a thriller experience of this kind of type where, you know, somebody gets caught in a moral bind and then the suspense of, you know, the whole world's closing in around them or they're about to lose everything. But, you know, so I don't know. I mean, my gut says don't recommend it. So I guess that's what I'm going to stick with. But it's not a horrible movie. It's just not really distinguished by anything. You know, there's no scenes that you go like, you got to see it because it's a crazy movie where this happens, you know? Mm-hmm. I guess maybe that's it.
Not even the Iliad scene, as crazy as it implausible as that was.
I don't know if I'd recommend it for that, but maybe you're right. That might be the thing. I would say that's the thing that I would remember about it. I've seen this movie before, and I was sitting there tonight, and like I did not remember a single thing from it. So it was one of those like and just like flushed it. You know, it's like on to the next thing. So, yeah, I guess I'd say you can skip the boy next door. Holly, what'd you think?
Yeah, no, there was a lot of this movie that just annoyed the shit out of me. But at the same time, like, I like that. It's the same reason I like watching a fucking Lifetime movie. It's just so stupid. It's horribly made. And it just is hilarious, and that's kind of what this movie is to me. There's definitely a subsect of people who this movie is for. You know, it's like, I know me and Michaela have this. Yeah, it's me. Yeah. Michaela and I have this same passion. You know, we appreciate a Blumhouse movie. We appreciate like a horror movie, an erotic thriller, whatever. But the thing is, we also fucking like Lifetime movies. And that's what this movie is. We're that weird subsect where we're like, we love the eye gouge. We also love the fucking affair. Like, it's just, there's those components put together. It's a very select subsect of people. And that's Michaela and I. So, you know, this is right up my alley. I know that it's not up everyone's alley. I would not recommend this to a lot of people. But I personally enjoy this kind of thing because I think it's hilarious. There was so much of this movie that we were making fun of the entire time.
You guys all were like, what? As soon as they said the first edition of the Iliad, everyone was like losing their mind. Yeah. At that. Yeah.
I mean, the first like 2 seconds into this movie when she's running and having her little flashbacks over, we're all just like, what the fuck? And just laughing our asses off. Wow.
What are you doing?
As soon as you jump into this, you realize this is going to be ridiculous. And it really was. And I enjoyed it. I did. But again, I know not everyone would. So I would say if you fall into that subsect Michaela and I fall into, yes, I recommend The Boy Next Door. Sean?
I agree with Colin. I think that I don't mind watching Jennifer Lopez as an actress. I think she's very solid. She does a lot of good things. There's other movies she's done that I've enjoyed. I think the script is probably the biggest failure of this movie. I don't think they lean hard in a direction that would be more interesting to see these characters go. Like, I want to see Jennifer Lopez get caught up in the trappings of the Lifetime movies and like the better versions of this. Like, I want to see that ridiculousness, but I want to see Jennifer Lopez doing it.
Yeah.
And I don't think we get I can't say we didn't get the opportunities. The opportunities are there. But the filmmakers decided not to go in those directions.
Let me ask you this real quick. What? Sorry, I don't mean to interrupt your train of thought, but would it have been more interesting if they'd actually went and like, you know, we're going to try and kill this guy. And then they like, you know, if they did, then there'd be the suspense of like all the, you know, it's like that we've gone and killed somebody or, you know.
They did, though. They did kill him.
No, mm-hmm. I mean Kristen Chenoweth and J Lo. Like, oh, earlier, when they're trying to like, how do you get out? How do you keep this? Yeah,
it was like they did kill him. They dropped the fucking engine on him.
Yes. Yeah.
But that would change the fucking movie halfway through.
If it had been more plotting instead of survival.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. I agree.
Yes. Because that would have been these characters making a decision.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And I don't feel like they did that in this movie. They're just reacting to the things that are happening to them. They're not deciding to do things.
Isn't that more realistic, though? Wouldn't you just react to things? Maybe, but I'm not. In real life, you're not going to plot to murder someone because you fucked them and they want a blackmail.
But I'm not coming to this movie to see the realistic
things. We want the ridiculous.
But I think this movie thinks that's why you're coming here.
Probably.
I think it thinks you're tired of seeing the Lifetime thing. You want to see the more realistic take on the Lifetime thing.
Possibly.
Is what I think it assumes from the audience.
Right. But that's not why I would go see this movie. I want the characters making decisions and going with them and doing all that stuff. And I think that's what this lacks. These characters are just reacting to things that are happening to them and not deciding to do anything. And I think that's kind of the downfall of this movie. Again, this is some good stuff. It doesn't earn a lot of things. I don't think it earns its ending, really. No, I don't. I can't recommend it. It's like, it's not a horrible movie. Like, it's perfectly fine.
Perfectly fine?
It's competent, except for the glaring illustration, in some sense it's a watchable, incompetently made movie, not competently written.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, okay.
That's my biggest problem with it.
I think it could have just like leaned hard and gone for it.
Yeah.
It decided not to for some reason, and that's why I will pass on The Boy Next Door. Michaela.
I want to say I really appreciate that this movie had an R rating. I feel like a lot of times with these like erotic thrillers, they really rein it in because they feel like that's a genre that like teen girls are into. So like they try to keep it toned down so that teen girls will pay to go see it.
Right.
And so like I appreciate that it had an R rating. And I know that when Rob Cohen came aboard, he said, "I'm not making this movie unless I can have a full R."
Which good for him
for sticking to his guns on that. But like, where was that attitude for the rest of the movie? Like, why not stick to your guns on everything? And I know that like, I think he does deserve some credit for this movie because like in the final act, they had run out of money. And the like EpiPen eye stabbing scene was going to be completely trash because the prosthetic head cost $25,000 alone to make. So he had to go and Jason Blum would not give him any more money. So he went around Jason Blum to Universal, who had picked it up for distribution, and said, "Hey, I need $300,000 more so I can reshoot this car crash, make the burning barn look better, and so I can get this prosthetic head." And Universal said, "Fuck yeah, we'll give it to you." And so we got the ending of the movie we did because he went around Jason Blum.
Yeah.
If he had stopped at Jason Blum, we wouldn't have even gotten that. And how much worse would this movie have been without any of that? Yeah. So, I mean, I'm glad that he knows when to keep going and when to push it instead of when to just do what your boss tells you. I appreciate that about him. And I think that's the best thing you can give Rob Cohen is at least he knows when to push it. You know?
Right. Or if nothing else, he knows, like, we at least need this.
Exactly. Like, you know?
Bare minimum, this is what.
Right. Because, like, how much worse would this movie have been if you had basically been missing that whole third act? Like, yikes. It would not have been great.
Stabbed in the eye.
Yeah.
More face stabbings for this movie.
Yeah, for sure.
You got to give it a little juice, you know?
Yeah.
That being said,
literally, it leaked out of his face.
So I think Rob Cohen did the best he could with, you know, I know he called in some favors with like his Fast and Furious crew with the car crashes and stuff. He pulled strings wherever he could to make this like a profitable movie. But that being said, I think that's all Rob Cohen cares about is this going to make money? And as long as it makes my budget back and I get paid well, who gives a fuck if it's actually good? And I think that's why he has the career he does is because that's all he fucking cares about. And I think he's going to keep making movies like this until he dies unless he tries something different. However, this is a subgenre that I really find interesting and I really like. I don't know why. I just do. I think Obsessed has.
Hey, you like what you like.
I think Obsessed has bigger plot holes than this movie. Obsessed really makes no sense if you really take a good look at it compared to this one. This one's actually pretty tight as far as this genre goes with filling the plot holes. This one's well written, better than a lot of them. Obsessed, it's got some plot holes, but it's a good compliment to this movie. I haven't seen Unforgettable yet, but I had heard it had some glaring issues as well. This is just a genre I think it's hard to write because you're trying to keep it grounded in the sense that it's just a normal person that goes crazy. And so you are limited in what you can do in that sense of, like, you can't introduce crazy supernatural elements. You can't introduce, like, you have to stick within the realms of mental illness. So that limits a lot of what you can do. As much as we've talked about the problems of the movie, I still really enjoy it. I think it's a lot of fun. I think that J-Lo is better than this movie, which is weird because, like I said, I feel like her star is fading, but she's still better than this. But I do like that the financial success of this movie led to Get Out being able to be made. So I think that, like, even if you don't like this movie, you can like what it contributed to in the run of Blumhouse, because this is an era of Blumhouse I don't think we'll see again for a while. Because now they're above this, and now they're better than this. It's going to be your Happy Death Days, your Get Outs from here on out with Blumhouse, and that's about it. And a couple of Whiplashes here and there.
That's cool.
You know, which is not a bad thing, but yeah, this era of Blumhouse is over.
Now they're doing the Sharp Objects HBO show.
Yeah.
That's not like a three-set thing.
Yeah, no, this era of Blumhouse is a really thing like of the past. Show. It is over. You're not going to see anything like this from Blumhouse anymore.
They all do that. Like Lionsgate, they grow up.
Yeah. No, but you never notice. It's like they all have the same career. Trajectory. Blumhouse seems to be more drawn out, but like you look at New Line Cinema, all these places that start with horror, that eventually, you know, they graduate, then they spread their, you know, wings and get into TV distribution and television shows, and we're gonna now buy the, you know, the method by which our products are, you know, they'll buy a network or something, whatever the fuck, and then they go away, they explode, they implode, they go away. I'm like, just stick to what you do. Remember Anchor Bay Entertainment?
Where
the fuck are they now? You know?
I don't think Blumhouse is going to stop doing horror. I just think it's going to be more adult horror and more mature horror. Like, this is not a mature movie. This is a very immature movie.
Yeah.
That's why I like it. Like, it's like that. It's like, God, could you guys imagine this movie written by Kevin Williamson? How amazing it would be if this movie was written by Kevin Williamson. I would love to see that movie. Like, this movie's not very mature, but it thinks it is, you know? But the premise is just not a mature premise at all. And that's the thing. Like, I don't think Blumhouse is going to stop making horror. I think it's just going to be more refined, sophisticated horror from here on out. It's going to become like an A24 type thing, right? You know?
But do they become, like, does that change their model that they've been going after as far as their profits and stuff?
I think that depends on Jason Blum more than anything. I think it depends on what he sees as.
Well, they used to be at the million mark. Now they're at, like, I think their average movie
is like 6 million
is like
now, right?
5 to 6.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So they have changed a little bit.
They'll expand a little bit. I mean, as long as they don't.
And they're probably acquiring fewer movies, you know, instead of putting out 20 things a year. Now it's 10.
Right. Mm-hmm. As long as they just don't, like, go into overdrive.
Yeah.
And just, if
they're going to, though. That always happens.
I mean, I
they're going to,
happens.
And they're
going to
crash and burn, and then we'll never hear from them
again.
Because
eventually you got to take your stock public. And
I'll buy into their stock when they go public. I've talked for way too long. Sorry. I would recommend it because this is a genre I love. The campier, the better. The more ridiculous, the better. I wish it had been more ridiculous and pushed it a little further. I get it was trying to be realistic and be a little more grounded, but I don't really care about that when I come to watch these types of movies. So I would recommend it because I think it's fun. Yeah.
There you go.
So that brings us to the end of The Boy Next Door. Thank you for joining us. And next week we're going to be watching a movie that's chosen by
Holly. Holly, what are we going to watch? What are you making us watch next week?
What I'm inviting all of you to join.
All of you join us.
All of you. You can all be a part of this.
You can all be a part of this because I don't know if you know this, but we've been talking about for a while how much we want a big budget monster movie. And you know what?
We're getting it. God damn it.
We are being blessed this summer.
I feel like I'm being yelled at.
We're being blessed. We are closing out the summer with a freak show field trip, and we're seeing The Meg.
Yes.
I'm just like basking in the glow of the taglines on the posters. It's like opening wide on August, whatever.
Yeah, I love it. I love it.
If you don't do things like that, I'm disappointed.
Yeah. Yeah. Right.
Despite how I feel about your movie,
the other one's Pleased to Eat You.
Yeah. Oh, I love it. I love it. Give me all the fun taglines.
Yeah. Oh, wonderful.
So that's next week. Freak Show Field Trip, The Meg. You'll have seen it already, I think, a week before we get around to it. But tune in then, damn it. Please listen to us.
We'll be spoiler free then.
That's right.
I mean, we'll be able to speak freely about it because it'll be out for a week.
Go watch the damn movie.
Yeah.
I'm going to see it. I have to.
We're all going to watch it.
All right. So that's next week on the Saturday Night Freak Show. And until then, the basement is going dark.